Welcome to the Ministry of Living on the Edge with Chip Ingram. We trust that the upcoming message will inspire, encourage, and motivate you to apply what you learn as you live out your faith in Christ at home and at work each day. At the end of the message, you'll find information on how to contact Living on the Edge or obtain additional resources. Now, here's Chip.
Mirrors are very powerful things. You can kind of think something about yourself and walk into the bathroom and go, oh my, it's not exactly what I thought. Or the lighting, I've learned, I have to travel a lot, and the lighting in the bathrooms in airplanes is extraordinarily revealing. It is not soft light. You can go in there to brush your teeth and age 10 years or just see what you've never seen before. But there's not just physical mirrors that are powerful. There's mirrors that we all have. It's the mirrors of a little boy looking up when he does something, and it's a mom's disapproval. She didn't even say anything. It's the mirror of going to school early on and thinking, wow, don't you really look cool? And you realize about 3 minutes later, you don't not only look cool, but people are laughing at you. It's the mirrors of disapproval from your spouse. It's the mirror of a boss who says, you don't measure up. It's the mirror of someone who says, you're dumb. You're lazy. You'll never amount to anything. It's the mirrors of the media that say that if you don't have this perfect body in this perfect way, that you really aren't acceptable. And there's all kind of mirrors that over time have told you this is who you are. Now, what I want to tell you is how you think about yourself and who you really are can be drastically different. I had an experience early on. I was must have been my last year in college. By this time, I finally was a growing Christian. It really took me a while to get going, but I was spending time in God's Word. I was in a Bible study. I was teaching a little bit to some other college kids, and I played basketball in college, and we had a year-end tournament, and we had lost the game in the tournament, so the last game in the tournament, and it was in another city, and so most all of the team members, after you lose a game in the last season, all the rules go out, and everyone was going to go party and do some wild and crazy things to drown their sorrows. And as a believer in the Lord Jesus, that wasn't my agenda. And there was a cheerleader, not a girlfriend, no relationship of any kind, but she did not want to do that scene either. And I found myself in a little coffee shop talking to Marilyn for one of those like three-hour conversations. It was after the game, and you know, it was just a quiet little coffee shop, and I actually, you know, never talked to her because she was very intimidating externally. She was a cheerleader. She had long blonde hair, straight white teeth, beautiful blue eyes, 3.7 grade average. I mean, it was just like, I mean, you know, she would never want to talk to someone like me. And so we found ourselves in this little coffee shop, and we were talking, and I just thought, I mean, she's like, you know, the 1% of the gene pool. You know, how does God make certain people like this, and then there's the rest of us? And I remember talking to her, and after a couple hours, I was like shaking my head and saw the dissonance between objective reality and how we can view ourselves. As I listened for 2 hours, I listened to a girl who hated herself. I listened to a girl who objectively thought she was ugly. I listened to a girl that didn't date very much because she thought all these guys that were asking her out all the time, which were many, and she said no, is they were patronizing her because they wouldn't ever really like her. And if she went out with them, then they would get to know her and realize the kind of person she is, and she would never get a second date. So she said no to most of the first ones. Of course, what happened? She was perceived as being this stuck-up, beautiful blonde. And I listened to her, and I thought, 3.7, well, you don't understand. You know, perfection is 4.0. I'm a failure. She was in one of the most rigorous places. I was at a school that they trained dental hygienists, and it was really hard to get in, and there was five or six people for every slot, and of course, she got it and was on top of the class. So on the one hand, this girl has everything going for her that you can imagine, you know, from brains to looks. And on the other, her perception of herself was ugly, unworthy, failure, unacceptable. See, over time, some people had given her a reflection of some mirrors that said, Marilyn, you don't measure up. You're unlovable. And so how did she respond to people? It framed her whole life. And I want to encourage you by the fact that all of us have had some warped mirrors in our past. All of us have insecurities and some fears of relating to others. We all have warped mirrors. Over the years, I've seen this in pastoral counseling, and not always to the extreme as a Marilyn, but everybody has some pictures of yourself that really don't add up. We experience distortions that affect our lives, our relationships, because of mirrors past and present. It's a lot like when you're a little kid and you grow up. It's like, you ever been to one of those fun houses where you go to, you get in one mirror and it looks like you're like 8 feet wide, and then you run to the next mirror and it looks like you're a toothpick and 11 feet tall, and then you go to another mirror and you go to another mirror, and it shows you all these different mirrors, and then there's sort of the regular one that's, quote, normal. You need to understand there have been people, experiences, trauma, rejection, media that have happened in your life that have implanted little warped mirrors that have come together to tell you who you think you are. One author put it this way. It was very insightful. He says, we are not what we think we are. We are not even what others think we are. We are what we think others think we are. We're going to talk about overcoming a warped self-image. And a self-image is the mental picture or concept of oneself as a person. It's your own idea of who you are, your sense of worth. It's the composite picture of all those mirrors that have come together over time. And you get stuck here. You get stuck here. I mean, we had a whole movement. Remember the self-esteem movement about 15, 20 years ago? We had a whole movement that thought this was the answer to everything. Unfortunately, the self-esteem movement was built on, we wanted everyone to feel good about themselves based on almost nothing. But what I want to do is I want to spend some time, and we're going to look at sort of the problem, and here's the outline in your mind. We're going to talk about how do we as people develop our self-image? How do those mirrors come together where you have a picture, a composite picture in your mind of who you think you are? Then what I want to do is show you briefly what's the impact of that if it's inaccurate. And then we're going to get to the really good news where God's going to say, there is a mirror that's accurate. There is a mirror that's accurate 100% of the time, and you're going to have these kind of mirrors. They don't go away, do they? You have neighbors, church members, people, sons, daughters, friends. You're always getting perceptions from people, and God's going to say, here's a mirror. And I'm going to show you who I not only think you are, but who I made you to be. I'm going to show you that you're fearfully and wonderfully made. And I'm going to show you that with your warts and your hurts and your background and your baggage, I'm going to say some things about those of you that are in Christ that will shatter the warped mirrors of your past. Now, what you know from all the research is that the most powerful influence in your life about your self-perception is your parents, your family of origin, your mom, your dad, or lack thereof. The second most powerful thing we learn over time is that authority and role models, as well as peers over time, people that you look up to, people that have leverage. It can be an older brother and sister. It can be a sports hero. It can be a pastor. We all have people in our lives that we look up to, and so what they think carries more. Our peers. There's a season, especially in the teenage years, where what our peers think. And then you have the media sending you messages all the time telling you, you know, this is how you need to look. This is what you need to drive. This is what's cool. This is what's out. This is what's in. This is the kind of school you need to go to. These kind of people are really wonderful. These kind of people are not very wonderful. You need to be so tall. You need to be so skinny. You need to own this. You need to do that. And then all the while, God has given us a conscience, and the conscience inside of us is built to say, this is right and this is wrong. But your conscience gets trained. And so your conscience gets educated and trained. So some people have an overdeveloped conscience where they feel very guilty about things that God says are not wrong. And so they live with overwhelming guilt and shame. Often early on, this comes from, you know, a family of origin background or from an ultra-legalistic view of life. On the other hand, some people's conscience, it's underdeveloped. And they can use people, abuse people, not even feel bad about it. But your conscience and the condemnation, lack of condemnation, if it's not accurately attuned to Scripture, it sends you messages as well. All this together, then you have a world system that's very interesting. And the world system basically says it's about your appearance, your performance, and your status. So the world is going to tell you that how you look, what you can do, and who do you know, right? I mean, isn't that? So, for example, if you would take, I only brought one. Often I bring five or six magazines, and so I decided not to bring some of the usual ones. But I thought I would start with, now this is, you. If you go out of the grocery store, every time you go out of the grocery store, you need to understand that the messages of the media of the world are screaming at you and saying to you, this is how you need to look, this is what you need to have, this is what makes you secure or significant or worthwhile. And so People magazine are going to tell us things about, oh, those are the beautiful people, right? And Forbes is going to say, if you get more zeros, then you're really a somebody. And Cosmo or 17 or Vogue or Us are going to say, if you can look like this, right? And so I have, you know, if you're on the first few rows here, I picked up today, just a little went to the grocery store. This is Vogue magazine. You have two beautiful women on each side, and then you have a guy whose full-time job is to create abs. No one gets bodies like this without a lot of money, surgery, and your full-time job is in the gym. And yet, so I walk out, and I'm just, you know, I'm like, I only got three small kids I'm taking care of as a woman, or I'm a 17-year-old, and I look at 17 or Us, and what I'm told is, guys, that's acceptable. This is 1% of the gene pool with a lot of money and a lot of time and touched-up pictures. But you're fed that every commercial, every billboard, every magazine. And then if they really want to sell you something, if you're a woman, they have someone who looks like this. This does not exist. No one can be this beautiful. I mean, this is hours of makeup. There's a fan blowing. This is, I mean, the cheekbones have been, you know, raised by the computer. I mean, no one can actually look this beautiful in this kind of light. But just so the guys don't feel out of it, does that man look absolutely fantastic? Is this man sexy or not, huh? He is a hunk. And if you wear this cologne, the women will come after you. And then page after page after page in this magazine is of people who, if you only look like them, then you'd be a somebody. All I want you to see is you are living in a system that rewards maybe 1 or 2% of the entire population, that focuses on things you can't control and tells you resounding messages from the day you were born, you're unacceptable, you don't measure up, you're unwanted, you're not significant, and you're not secure. And even as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, whose Spirit dwells in us, left to ourselves, with our minds not renewed, and without a sensitivity to block some of those messages, we can love God, think things are going exactly the way we think He wants us to go, and we can spend our time and our energy and our money performing and seeking status and doing all the kind of things that those messages say to fill holes in your hearts of a warped self-image, thinking, if you know what, if I could only look like that, if I could just get that surgery, if I could just drive that car, if I could just have more of those bags with a little design so people at the airport know I'm a really important person, if I could just get the kind of watch that people understood, if we could just get this remodeled, you know what, if we could just go to vacation in these kind of places, if I just got to know some, if our kids could just get SAT scores, that if they could go to prestigious college, if my kid could get on the traveling team, why? Why? Because there's deep holes in who you think about yourself and who I think about myself. And we are searching for significance and security and acceptance in how we look, what we can do or perform, and the status that we achieve. And we achieve status by our wealth, by our notoriety, by our education, by the people that we know. And then what we can do is we can take all of those and sort of baptize them and bring them into the Christian community. And then we know really cool Christian people. And it's by how much of the Bible that we know. And it's, right? The impact of a warped self-image is insecurity and inferiority. It produces a performance orientation. Anybody know any fellow Christians that are workaholics? Why? Well, why would you be driven to work, go, achieve? Why? Because that's your worth. For others, it produces withdrawal. I mean, how many times as a woman, how many times are you going to see this and realize, you know what, I don't think I can ever compete with that. I don't have a full-time chef. I don't have a full-time trainer. I don't have people that can give me surgeries when I start to sag. And you just withdraw and you say, I just can't go there. I quit. I give up. In the Christian community, we're not immune to any of this. And so our responses are denial. Often our responses are, we compensate. We do things like give stuff to our kids to make us feel like we're successful. We have addictive behavior. Now, as Christians, often it's the same as the world. It might be prescription drugs or alcohol, but often it's, you know what? It's eating. It's going to the refrigerator. It's ministry. It's people-pleasing. It's codependency. There's a lot of unhealth and dysfunction that become sort of respectable Christian sins, but you know what? You don't experience the power of God. You don't experience the love of God, and we reproduce the dysfunction in our own children and grandchildren. And so we have these unfulfilled longings for significance and unconditional acceptance that results in people that are very, very unhappy. Now, here's the thing. Here's the irony of God. I wish I don't know the three people in the front of that magazine. I don't know their names, and I purposely didn't go with the big stars. And I could name, you know, we could say, well, who are the people on American Idol, or who are the people in the world's next model, or who are the people that are the big baseball stars, football stars, basketball stars, and whatever reality shows coming, and whatever names are not changed 5 years will be different names. All I can tell you, the 1% of the gene pool that's making $10 to $12 to $20 million a year, who are the most beautiful people in the year, had the most prestigious jobs, and whether that's entertainment or whether that's business or whether that's CEOs, you just look at the pattern of suicide, divorce, relational fallout, misery, unhappiness, and addictions. So what we all, consciously or unconsciously, are chasing, the 1% that have it, tell us it produces no happiness. It produces no peace. So what I want you to understand here too is that's not just sort of psychological stuff. There is an enemy to your soul called Satan, who led a third of the angels, who are now called demons, and his primary MO is lies. You don't need to have stuff move in your house. You don't need to have, you know, visual manifestations of demonic activity. You don't need to be in places where it's overseas, where it's bizarre, where demonic activity is occurring. I will tell you what, as long as we believe lies given to us gently about performance, status, significance, and success, that you need to look like that or perform like that or own that, you know what? He'll be glad to stay undercover and let us chase the wrong things and ruin our lives trying to fill these holes in our warped self-image. So there's a spiritual battle going on. When we're going to talk about making some of the changes and renewing your mind and getting a new focus and seeing how God sees you, I just want to warn you, it won't be just, you know, some new thinking. There's going to be resistance to you disciplining yourself to learn who you really are in Christ. There'll be some discipline to say, you know something? There's certain things I can't watch anymore. There's certain people that maybe I shouldn't hang out because it always drives me to these same places of comparison. These same places of condemnation. These same places of, I don't measure up. I'm unworthy. Now, the great thing is that God has some amazing good news, awesome good news, powerful good news. He's going to say that I want you to see yourself the way I see you. Notice at the very top of your notes, it's Romans chapter 12, verse 3. What does God say about self-image? He says that you're not inferior. He says you're not worthless. You're not insignificant. He says, I made you exactly the way I made you. You have a DNA that no one else on the planet, almost 7 billion people, you are unique. You're valuable. You're loved. You're accepted if you're in Jesus Christ. And here's the deal. Here's his command. For through the grace of God given to me, the Apostle Paul would write, I say to every man, every person among you, not to think more highly of himself than he ought to think, but to think is to have sound judgment as God has allotted to each a measure of faith. I'd like you, in your notes, underline the word think every time it comes up. He's just told you to offer your body as a living sacrifice, verse 1. He said, stop being conformed to the pattern of this world, the vogues, the people, the cosmo, the Forbes. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind so you can experience God's will, that it's good, acceptable, and perfect. Now what he says is you need to have a right view of yourself. Don't think too high of yourself. Don't think too low of yourself. Think. And then that word sober judgment. The word for sober, same root word as think. All significant life change begins in your thinking, not your behavior, not even in your attitudes, not even emotions or trying hard. As a man thinks in his heart, so he is. The mind set on the flesh is death. The mind set on the spirit is life and peace. Set your mind, Colossians 3, on the things that are above, not on the things that are on earth, where Christ is. Chapter 4 of Ephesians. What's he say? Take off the old man. Have your mind renewed. Put on the new man. Thinking. He says, think accurately about yourself. The opposite word, this word for sober is used, the opposite of is people that are drunk. They're intoxicated. When you're drunk or intoxicated, what's true of you? You have a warped perception. Hey, you know what? It's only 4 stories down. Hey, watch me. I can go on this ledge. Duh, dumb perception. See, when you're drunk, your mind is influenced in a way where reality is blurred. And what God is saying is, for some of us, your self-image has been warped. And it's been warped by the sort of the spiritual, emotional, media, and family alcohol, so that when you think about who you really are, it's wrong. It's not true. And he says, I want you to think accurately about yourself according to the measure of faith. And this is not a subjective faith. Here, he's talking about the objective faith, the truth of Scripture. And so here is the mirror. I'm going to share some stories about, you know, where we've been and the transformation in our lives. I can tell you, I'd never opened the Bible until I was 18 years old. And when I began to deal with, and my wife and I began to deal with the lies that we believed about, you know, my performance is who I am, or you have to look a certain way. One is, in this life, I don't think you ever fully get over it. But when you renew your mind with God's word and you begin to see yourself the way God sees you, and you first think it, and then you believe it, and then you feel it, amazing things happen. Transformation occurs. A lot of the pull, a lot of the temptation, a lot of the addiction, a lot of the stuff that you deal with, all of a sudden it loses its hold. Because you break it. You'll know the truth, and the truth will set you free. So here's the truth we want to talk about. Where do you get an accurate view of yourself? The first 6 verses of Ephesians give us an amazingly accurate view of ourselves. This was a circular letter. He's writing to the church, and if you're familiar with the book, he takes chapters 1, 2, and 3 to say, this is who you are. This is the work of Christ. When Christ died in your place for your sin and rose from the dead, and the moment that you trusted in Christ, you're united with him. The Apostle Paul would say you died with him, you were resurrected with him. Ephesians will say you're actually seated with him in the heavenly places. There is this bond. Whatever is true of him is now true of you. And so he's going to say in the first 3 chapters, this is true of you. These are not verses about ought or should or try. He's saying, this is true of you. Chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4. Therefore, I urge you, my brothers, in view of this, walk in a manner worthy of the Lord. The word, we get our word axis. That word worthy is axis. He's saying, here's three chapters of truth. All of this is true of you. Now, the Christian life is not trying hard to be a good person. The Christian life is by faith, in community, through God's word, believing and trusting that what he said is true. So let your behavior and your beliefs start telling the same story. And then when he opens up chapter 4, he says, well, it starts with attitudes. It starts with humility. It happens in community. It's rooted in the cross, the role of the church, renewing your mind. And then he goes through and says, let me show you what this looks like, right? In a world with you're bombarded, early of chapter 5, he talks about how to be sexually pure, then how to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and then what it looks like when you're living out this new truth in a marriage relationship, and then as parents, and then in work, and then in a context of spiritual warfare. And that's the whole book. But he's going to start by telling you who you really are. This is the mirror he wants you to hear. Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God to the saints, just that word means those that are set apart, believers, who are at Ephesus, who are faithful in Christ Jesus. And we skip over this, but listen, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes, it's an introduction. Yes, it's a preamble, but the very first words out of his mouth are grace to you. Grace, what you don't deserve, acceptance, love, concern, grace to you from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ, and peace. And this word is, it's the shalom of God. It isn't just peace like the absence of conflict. It's not just an emotional peace. This is the well-being, the wholeness of God. He says, God's unmerited, the one who spoke and billions of galaxies came into existence and out of his mouth spoke life and truth. Out of his mouth comes to you grace, blessing, and love, and acceptance, and the shalom, and the wholeness, and the peace of God. And then the thesis of this entire first chapter is in verse 3. He said, blessed be, it's a prayer, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. And it's sort of think, blessed, thank you, wow. And then he says, why? Who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. And what he's going to do, actually, the next 13, 14 verses, the Apostle Paul goes nuts. It's one long sentence. And he just starts talking about, oh, Father, I want to bless you for all the spiritual blessings that we already possess. And then it's like a machine gun going off, bam, 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 bam. You know, you did this, you did this, you did this, you did this, you did this. And we're going to walk all the way through it. And you're going to see who you are. You are not who your mother said you were. You are not who the media says you were. You're not even who your conscience says you are. You are not what the workplace says you are. You aren't what People or Forbes or 17 or reality show says you are. You're not what your pastor says you are. You're not what your kids think you are. You're not what your best friends think you are. You are, if you're in Christ, you are who God says you are. And you get that, it'll change every one of those relationships. Because if you don't, you will spend your life trying to please, approve, dodge, denial, and compensate. Because all those people I just named, they all have a different mirror of you, don't they? They all have different expectations of you, don't they? And you want them all to like you, don't you? Have you come to the realization it's impossible? Isn't it? You can't. So how about this? What if you understood who God says you are and you lived out of God and his identity, and then your only job would be just to be you? Here's what's weird. If, in fact, your DNA, and we all learn this from CSI, if it really is unique, and God gave it only to you, I think we could go on record by mere logical deduction that the most attractive thing that you could ever be would be just you. That looks like you. Not like her. Well, not like him. That how you process information, that what your gifts are, and in his sovereignty, since we know he works all things together for the good, even in a fallen world, that who you are and where you're at right now, the real you showing up would be the absolute most freeing and attractive person to your friends, your kids, your mate, your pastor, your boss, your neighbors. And a lot of us, we don't have a clue of who we are. We really don't. And that's why later in this same chapter, he will say, let love be, NIV says, sincere. New American Standard says, let love be without hypocrisy. And the Greek word there is, literally, it's let love be without a mask. Abhor what is evil, cling to what is good. See, you never have real community, you never have intimacy, you never get tight with people until the real you shows up. And at some level, we all do this. We project, right? We have these little holograms that I'm a little kinder, I'm a little nicer, I'm a little more holy. I mean, I want you all to think that, okay? Even as I'm talking about that, I still want you all to think that in my flesh. But the more you can reduce the distance of who you are trying to project yourself to be and that being who you really are, wow, that when someone gets to know the real you and they really accept the real you, is it like awesome? You know what that is? That's called love. Because see, they're not loving you for what you do. They're not loving you for who you know. They're not loving you for what you have. And they're not loving for you for what you look like. They're loving you. So he says, let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil, cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love, giving preference to one another in honor, not lagging behind in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. There's this amazing thing that God wants for us in community. But if I go into that with this warped self-image, I will just manipulate and work all those things in my Christian small group to get people to accept me. And even when they do, then here's the sad part. What you know down deep is, oh, they like you, but you know it ain't you. Is that sick or what? I've now figured out how to get these Christians in my small group, my church, to like this person I'm pretending to be. And you know what? In those really quiet moments when you finally move away from the refrigerator and put down the remote and you're just with you, it's a lonely, scary place. Because what you realize is all those people in your small group, they don't really know you and they don't really love you. Of course, you haven't let them. So this is the journey where we're going to talk about how God thinks about you. And then we're going to start a journey of the hard work of getting that from an intellectual stage into your heart, into your life. And you'll have breakthroughs, but the difference will be in the next 6 to 9 months or year or two or three will be you literally saying, whatever it takes for me to not believe the lies and to renew my mind with the truth, I'm going to do that. And when you do that, I will tell you what, you'll discover who you are. And a different person will show up at that small group. And you'll sit with friends or even with your mate and you'll experience acceptance because the real you is showing up. And he says, so what are these spiritual blessings? He gives three. Just as he chose us in him before the foundations of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. Number one, circle the word he chose us. So that's a spiritual blessing. Second, in love, he predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to himself, according to the kind intention of his will or for his good pleasure. And third, it's a purpose clause, to the praise or for the purpose of praising the glory of his grace, which he freely bestowed on us in the beloved, speaking of Christ. And so there's three very clear things he's saying. And here's something that's maybe a little new moment for you, is these verses actually were not put in scripture for people to argue about. This comes as a shock. So I want you to circle, he chose us, and then I want you to circle, he predestines us. And the word chose here, it means to pick out, it means to elect. It's like in the Old Testament, God says, I chose Israel. Well, he chose Israel not because he didn't care about the other nations. He chose Israel to make them an example so all could hear and all would respond. But notice, he chose us before the foundations of the earth, but that we would be holy, that we'd be set apart. He chose us for himself. So often, you know, we'll get to the issues that are controversial and I'm going to touch on, but for those of you, maybe this is more boys and girls, I don't know, but if you ever have been in a gym class or a neighborhood and they're choosing sides, and if you were real athletic, good for you, or if you were bigger than most of us, I always ended up playing with like guys 3, 4, 5 years older, and so, you know, they're choosing up teams. It's out in the front yard, you know, 3 driveways, first down here, you know, and I just so wanted to get to play. And the 2 captains get out there and they start, what? Choosing. And the big, fast, strong guys, I want you, I want you, I want you. Have you ever been where it gets down to like 2 people? And you're just thinking, I sure hope I get chosen. And then they don't. Oh, you're too small, you're too young, go sit down on the curb. You know, a lot of you, a lot of us have spent our life feeling like that's what we've received. You know the real meaning of this text? The real meaning of this text is not, well, is God completely sovereign or do we have a free will? Answer is yes, both. Here, you know why this is written? This is written so you would know that when all people were lined up for the game of life, God wants you to know, I chose you. I want you. I want you. I care about you. I died for you. I want to have a relationship with you. I want to hold you. I want to hug you. I want to heal you. I want to love you. I chose you, and I chose you for a purpose that you would reveal my glory so that you'd be holy. You'd be set apart. You'd be pure. You'd be blameless. The word is used of sacrifices in the Old Testament that had to be without defect. He chose you for himself because he has a purpose for your life. But God chose you. You are wanted. You may have had parents that haven't wanted you. You may have had a mate who've walked out on you. You may have kids who've rejected you. You may have people in church that have talked about you. You may have had all kind of experience of rejection. But here's what God says. You can live with those warped little mirror messages forever and let them define you. Or you can start saying, I'm wanted. I'm wanted by the person who created everything, who knows everything, and he wants me because he chose me. The second thing he says is the word predestined just means he preordered, he foreknew. It literally has the idea of understanding clearly. He predestined or prearranged knowing, but he to adopt you. There's 2 words in the New Testament, for one's for a child that's young and one's for a son. And he says he predestined to adopt you as his son or his daughter. How? Through Christ. Why? His pleasure. The Roman law, this meant a lot. If you read this as a new Christian in Ephesus, you're going, literally, are you kidding me? Because see, in Roman law, if you were adopted, not as a child, but as a son, then you actually became a part of that person's family. And there was a real rigorous process they went through. It was like your old life disappeared. Even any debts that you had were gone and forgiven because that person didn't exist anymore. And you would come as a son into this family or a daughter into this family. And now everything they had, you had. And that's what he's saying about you. You're not only wanted, you're accepted. You're a daughter. You're a son. Everything that's available to Jesus is available to you. The way Jesus talked to people, the way he loved people, the way he accepted people, and whether you're the religious person who didn't get it like Nicodemus, or whether you're the person that's been through all the pains and the 5 husbands like the woman at the well, Jesus says, I adopted you into my family the moment you put your faith in Christ, and I'm going to do for you what I did for her. You're accepted. I don't look at your past. I don't look at what you've been through. I look at you through the shed blood of the forgiveness and the redemption. You matter to me. I don't care who's rejected you ever. I accept you. I don't accept you if. I don't accept you because. I don't accept you because how you look. I don't accept you because what you've done. I don't care how many businesses you've started. I don't care if you won a beauty contest. I accept the real you. Before the foundations of the earth, before you did anything, I wanted you and I adopted you to be in my family and I purposed that you would have significance because your joy would be to, by your life and your words, to declare who I really am, what's it like to be loved, the praises of the glory of God. That's who you are. Now, if you've never put your faith in Christ, this is not true of you. But I just want you to notice what it says. Blessed be the God of the Father who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ. So you have to be in Christ. The moment a person understands that you've sinned and violated the truth of God's holy character and you turn from your sin, the Bible calls that repentance, and in the empty hands of faith, trust and believe that when Jesus died upon the cross, he died for you in your place. And when he rose from the dead, he proved that it was true. And there's new life and resurrection and opportunity, and you can receive that as a gift. And literally, the scripture says you're taken out of the kingdom of darkness and you're placed in the kingdom of light. And then actually, the Spirit of God enters your body. You're sealed with the Holy Spirit. He deposits spiritual gifts. You're adopted into his family. You have an inheritance. You have assurance of heaven. He lives inside of you, and he's going to live out his life through you. And so if you're in Christ, he says, I want you because I chose you. If you're in Christ, I accept you. And if you're in Christ, you are significant because I have a plan for you. I want to give you some real practical ways about moving this truth from ideas to reality. As I do, if you are in Christ, this is what God's mirror says about you. You are, write the word, wanted. Chosen. Every minute of every day by one who knows every aspect of your life, past, present, and future. Now what I know is, getting that from here to here is the real test. You're wanted. Could I ask you before we go on, where do you feel unwanted? Who makes you feel unwanted? What situations or environments make you feel unwanted? What people in your past have wounded you and made you feel like you weren't worthy of being wanted? See, those are deeply planted in your psyche and in your soul, and you unconsciously respond to those trying to get people to want you. And it's frustrating. And it doesn't work. Or if it does work, it's almost worse, because then they like this person you're pretending to be. But every single minute of every day when the thought comes to you that I'm unworthy or I'm not wanted, you could begin to say, Jesus wants me. God wants me. His thoughts are more important than anyone's thoughts. And he knows everything about me. He knows what I did in high school. He knows what I did on that business trip. He knows attitudes I've had. He knows bitterness I've had. He knows the secret aspects, and he wants me. He wants me. He chose me, because he didn't chose me because about something in me. He chose me because something in him. He loves me, and he chooses whosoever would believe. Second, you're accepted because you're adopted eternally into God's family with all the rights and privileges and blessings given to his children. And so I just ask you, who makes you feel unaccepted? What situations make you feel rejected? What family relationships or in-laws or traumatic experiences have sort of seared your soul with, you're not accepted, you're not worthy, you're not lovable? Truth is, everyone in this room, you've had them. Some a lot more than others. I have a friend, he's one of my mentors. His name is Bill. He was a professor at the seminary where I went to school, and later does leadership around the world for organizations. And he's one of the most godly men I've ever known. He has said things to me that were very painful and very loving. He's coached my wife and I through a number of ups and downs over the years. And his name is Bill. And when Bill was a little boy, he was born, and I don't know all the story about his birth mother, but he got sort of bounced around to different foster homes you know, as a cute little baby until he was about 4 or 5 years old. And then foster homes didn't want him, so they put him in an orphanage. And he was in an orphanage until he was about 8. And then one day, a couple walked in that orphanage, and he had been through this drill before, looking, looking, hoping, hoping, looking, looking, hoping, hoping, and someone else always gets chosen. But on this day, this couple chose Bill. And he tells the story of going home, and, you know, an orphanage, you shared everything, and you could only have food at certain times, and you lived in a dorm room, and, you know, let's face it, it's an orphanage. And he said, I went to this couple's home, and I got their last name, and it was official, and they showed me, and I was old enough to understand it. And there was this bedroom, like one whole room just for me, and they opened the closet, there were toys in it. And he said, you know, my new mom, she didn't feel like a mom, and my new dad, he didn't feel like a dad, but he said they were, and it was legal, and I now had their last name, and they showed me, and, you know, they opened up the refrigerator, my eyes got to be this big, and he said the first night I laid on the floor because I didn't think that was too nice of a bed for someone like me. And I didn't feel like, they said they were my toys, but I just couldn't bring myself to play with those toys because usually there were 2 or 3 toys for everyone. And I would go to the refrigerator, I would take stuff and I would hide it in my pockets and take it to my room because that's what you did at the orphanage. And what he said was, it's a powerful, powerful story. And he talks about a breakthrough. He later became a pastor, and he will talk about his broken world experience as a pastor of trying to keep everything in control. He got his PhD. He was the top of his class. He was a performance-oriented, off-the-chart workaholic from those early warped self-images, trying to prove he's a someone until he learned that it's in brokenness there's healing. And he said it took years as a little boy to accept what was true. They are my mom and dad. I can go to the refrigerator anytime I want, and I can open it, and I can get just enough for right now, and I don't have to hoard anything. And that bed I can sleep on because it's for me, because they love me. He said all of that was true, but I had been trained for the first 8 years of my life to believe that I was unwanted, not acceptable, unlovely, and unworthy. And it transferred into most of his adulthood until he hit a wall, until his performance just got him to the point where he about broke. Or for some of you, there's two extreme groups in this room. And I don't say this like I have some prophetic gift. It's just life. I would say there's some of you that have been super successful, and you got to the end of the big rainbow, and you have the house, and you got the money, you've been successful, you've done this, you've done that, you got the extra house, this. Your kids got in good schools, and there's just something desperately empty when you're very quiet and very alone. It didn't deliver, even as a Christian. And there's other people here that you've been sexually abused, you've been through horrendous things, you've been through a marriage or two, you've had an abortion or two, and your life has just hit the skids in most painful ways, and you're trying to hold it together. And out of those two groups, what I will tell you is these people find it's empty and they realize that in brokenness there's healing. And these people get broken not because they choose it, but because it just happens. And because they don't have any other choice, they come because there's nowhere else to go. And what they learn, in brokenness there's healing. And God just takes regular people like us and says, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you rest. And so Bill's life was learning to believe and renew his mind that God loved him, that he was worthy, not by his performance, not by his A's, not by the churches he could grow, that he was wanted, that he was accepted. The final thing we learn here is significance. And since you're called to reflect his eternal, holy, and blamelessness in a fallen world and declare and speak well of the grace freely available to all in Jesus, you are significant. You matter. My wife and I understood these. We were 2 years, 3 years out of seminary. We were had a first church run, and my workaholism kicked in, and she didn't want to tell anybody about where she'd been and the struggle, and So she sort of kept her past and her hurts over here, and I just figured out how you could work 80 or 90 hours, and some people had mega churches. This was a mini church. We had 35 people in this little church in rural Texas. 34 were related, I learned about a year later. And I worked incredible hours, hit the wall, had to go to the hospital once in my workaholism, had to face some really painful things about what I needed to address in my life. And that little church finally grew to about 500 people. And then God called us to the opposite end of the country in California. And my friend Bill walked my wife and I through a journey that the seminary where I went to. It was a leadership evaluation and development. And this man told my wife, you need to share your story. You need to embrace the fact that you've been divorced and abandoned. You need to embrace the fact that you have two little boys. Chip, you need to be proud and embrace the fact that you got to adopt them. You are trophies of God's grace, and your hurts and your wounds and your family backgrounds and your alcoholism, God has redeemed, and he wants to put you on the mantle of grace to tell people there's hope when they have hurts. And so when we went to that next church, my wife said, I'd like to share my testimony the first night, and she did. And literally 50 women lined up to talk with my wife, and three or four people lined up to talk to me, the new pastor. But it was a beautiful thing, because what happened was they understood there's hope for someone like them. Now, what I will tell you is for 2 or 3 years, I don't want to exaggerate, so I'll say 2 years, my wife realized all these things we're talking about were lies. And there was a little book by William Backus called Telling Yourself the Truth. And then in our counseling, we learned multiple lies that we believed. And so she would write down all the lies that she believed on a card, and at the bottom write the word stop, and then flip it over, and we had it verse. And so before I went to work for 2 years, we would sit on the couch together, and she'd read it out loud, say stop, flip it over, and read the truth. And she renewed her mind. I am worthy. I'm worthy outside of my physical appearance. I'm accepted and loved. I'm beloved in Christ. And, you know, every aspect, and she read over those cards. And I was being the good husband because I thought, you know, my wife has these deep issues and I need to help her. But I was reading over the cards with her to help her. And what I realized was I just had more acceptable dysfunctional sins that produced this driven workaholic pastor who got rewarded for trying to gain people's love and approval for what I did. And it was in that journey of renewing my mind, I mean every morning, that by the grace of God, I got free. And I got where I could say, you know, it's okay to be insecure. It's okay if everyone doesn't like me. God does. It's okay if I don't please everyone. You know what? I'm going to be honest. I want to. But it's okay if they don't. I don't have to measure my performance by how big the church is or how small it is or whether I do this or whether I do that. I don't have to cow down to powerful people. You know what? They're beneath all that stuff that they're showing, they got struggles just like me. I need to love them. And I want to tell you that you can go on a journey and say, God, I want to declare war on my warped self-image. And I want to begin to renew my mind and believe that I am wanted, accepted, and significant in Jesus Christ.
As we wrap up this message, there may be some next steps you need to take, and we'd like to help you on that journey. If today's topic raised some additional questions or issues that you'd like to explore more in depth, take a look at Chip's series, Rebuilding Your Broken World, or Overcoming Emotions That Destroy. In addition, be sure to take some time to visit our website where you'll find a number of free resources, information on all our audio and video series, as well as timely updates and information from Chip. The web address is simply livingontheedge.org. That's livingontheedge.org.